What the questions are, you know, because I came to you with that question, like, what is that question again? I mean,
right.
the sample that you gave us is really helpful in that way. Just kind of have a definition for what that question was.
Okay. I put a note for myself there that I can build you guys that. So it's like, so you have that, and you can show, you know, this is what each question type does. It's called this, it does this.
Great.
So I will build that for you guys, and I'll put it in this course. So you have it. Go ahead.
What's a back tick for entering a formula?
What the heck is a back?
That's not you catching the fuck in the forest.
Yeah. The kind of ticks that get on your back.
I know what it looks like because it shows it in the example.
Where is it though? Right?
Yes!
It is above the tab button. So look on your tab button on your keyboard.
There is.
One is the tilde, right? Is that what that's called? Tilde? Yep. And the other one is the back tick. So if you did shift that button, it'd be tilde. If you just did, it's next to the one. That's probably a better way to say it. All right. So that's the back tick. This is what's needed for the formula question. If you don't know what the heck a back tick is. All right. Go ahead.
So a different question. This is entirely points-based.
Yes.
I'm struggling to visualize, other than a formative situation, on how that would even remotely work with our summative situation.
Okay.
Because if we enter in as points, if it's a 10-point quiz, and let's say there's 10 questions, let's make it really easy, do we then convert that to a rubric-based solution in the end if a student gets this many correct, it's an A, this many correct, it's a B, or is that 4 out of 10 is a 40%, so it goes to our percentage basis?
So what you're going to be able to do is add an outcome to each individual question.
So a rubric based on each individual question.
It'll look like that.
Okay.
It'll look like a rubric for every question.
Okay.
Now the way your outcomes are built, they look very similar to a rubric. And so if a student gets it correct, it'll talk to that learning mastery side of the gradebook. If you wanted to use it formatively, like I said before, you could set it to 0 points overall and still have students practice, and it'll never talk them to your learning mastery side of your grade book. Does that help?
Yeah.
Okay. Go ahead.
Isn't there an option to click in there when we're setting it up? Can't you say do not communicate with that? So you could set it up, and so they can see like 7 out of 8, but it's not going to go into that grade book at all.
Right. Yeah. You can have it not count to the grade book. Even if you had individual questions have a point value, if you set the overall quiz when you're first creating it to 0, it's not going to go in the grade. So students can still see feedback, they can still see how they did, it's not going to talk to any kind of grading at all. All right, great question. Oh, I should probably write this. To talk to learning mastery,
inside your quiz that talk to different outcomes should also set it back.
So then, like, do
about my image is my image of the four dogs. How did you do that? So I actually had the four dogs put together first before I imported it. Because the hotspot doesn't let you make collages like that. So like if you did have an image where you had multiple blocks, I actually used PicMonkey and I put the four together and then I imported it.
Keynote is also a great tool to use. An export as an image. Just put the four pictures and export it.
Another hotspot question that I had was, can you do multiple hotspots on one question, on one image? And you can't right now. So hotspot is one spot right now. Notice that I'm saying right now. So they are building multiple hotspots on one image. Well, Mar, you had another question that was about images. That I said not right now. What was that? Oh, can you drag and drop from Google, and that other was not right now. Yeah. All right. What else?
Teachers need to know that it's auto saving.
Okay. It is auto saving. So as you're building, it's saving about every 3 seconds. That's the same for students as they're taking it. What if someone asked you, why should I use this instead of old quizzes, which I'm comfortable with? What would you tell them, do you think? Say again?
It's way more powerful.
Okay, so it's more powerful than quizzes. Some other reasons why they might want to venture into this area right now, even though it's kind of new and maybe a little bit scary.
More options for diverse learning styles.
Okay. What else?
They probably learn more like our state testing, like ACT Aspire. I'm using the science portion is a lot more similar to this.
The stimulus with the piece on the, so that stimulus I think looks a lot like any kind of state testing. All right. Sure.
Because I don't know if I was doing this right. Because I was constantly like, I wanted to see what it looked like from the student view to make sure that this is looking okay. Is it, do you have to wait until you publish it and then go into the assignment?
You do. There's not, so this, that's probably something else that we need to put on this list of what something we need to remember. If you're used to Canvas regular quizzes, there's a preview button and there isn't one for quizzes next. So you do have to publish and then go into student view. They are building the preview. It will exist. It's just not there right now. Currently not a preview of quizzes next. I don't like that part either. It makes me nervous that maybe I did something wrong and I can't see it. I got very used to that preview button, so they are building it. It should be there by the fall, so hopefully by more usage. What do you think might get teachers excited about this tool beyond anything we just talked about? Okay, remind them it's auto grading. All right, there's one question type, or actually two, that aren't. Essay, we're not that smart yet. Okay, so essay, won't be automatically graded. We would want that anyway. But most question types are going to be automatically scored. That helps my grading load. It'll also help me when I want to look at how my students are doing, right? Because the reports will show me where students are excelling and where I need to reteach it and where reteaching needs to happen. All right. some of those new question types, right? Your students are dragging. They feel like I'm not just clicking. They're dragging. They're moving things around.
Yes.
All right. When would you use it? What would you use it for? Is it only a quiz? It's called Quizzes Next, but it doesn't have to be a quiz. So this is the thing. Like, you can use it for anything. This could be, and this is the same with, you know, regular quizzes. It could be homework. It could be exit ticket. It could be exit tick. It could be a quiz. It could be a test. It could be anything, right? Just an assessment. And Canvas is going to put it on your assignments list. So you can use it for almost anything, right? We talked about ways you could use it formatively. We just want to see where students are, get the feel for what they know. And then if we are going to use it for outcomes, we can use it as a more summative type of assessment. Any other thoughts about this tool? What question types would you encourage people to really try to learn more about? Which one did you like the best, either when you were taking it as a student or building it? The stimulus? Okay. Anything else? If you were thinking about a question type that you would really try to like message to teachers, is, oh, check this one out. So it sounds like those newer ones, those four newer ones I showed off. The other ones, yeah, we've seen them all before. Truth, false, multiple choice, those kind of things. All right. So what I'm going to do is build for you guys a really simple kind of one-page thing about the different question types and what they do, and I'll put that in a course so you have it. And then this is also in there, so if you ever want to refer back to what do we think about as a group for we need to talk about quizzes next and how we can use them and what might get the students excited about. Okay. We're going to take a break. See what time it is. Okay. It is 9:35. I'm going to give you a really decent break. Let's come back at 9:55, right? That was a pretty intense morning. So about 15, 20 minutes. If you have any additional questions, you can let me know. I think there's snacks back there. When we come back, we're going to dig into grading a little bit.